In the past 16 months, we've implemented one of our biggest projects yet, our agroforest. But nature showed us that a collapsed ecosystem affected by logging and invasive monocultures prone to wildfire can suddenly change everything. This episode is the story of our agroforest, from the first shovel to the cleaning of the ashes. A big part of our lands are covered by invasive species like mimosas and eucalyptus. These fast-growing trees may look beautiful, but they crowd out native plants, drain the soil of nutrients, and increase the risk of wildfires. That's why reforesting these areas with native species is so important, to bring back biodiversity, restore balance, and protect our ecosystem for the future. This is where our first major project begins, right next to our base camp. It will not only restore the land, but also act as a natural barrier against wildfires and a source of food for us, humans and fauna.
So before we intervened, this was a plantation of eucalyptus, a monoculture. And before that, this was actually the terraces of the people that lived in the village. So we're actually trying to recreate what used to be here in the old days.
Here, we're going to try and implement here a Syntropic agroforest, an agricultural system developed by Ernst Gotsch in the late 80s in Brazil, which aims to mimic nature. There are three core principles that this part of the project is going to follow. One of them is to always have some ground cover. Another one of them is to use plant consortiums, plants that work well together and benefit each other's productivity. And the last one is to have an organized system of pruning. These agroforest systems are very good in accelerating and optimizing the natural succession, for which we're going to be using a lot of autochthonous species that are from Portugal. One of the big advantages of these systems is that they're very efficient in restoring degraded ecosystems. It's going to produce a lot of biomass, and through the pruning that we're going to be doing, we're going to be returning this to the soil and increasing the amount of organic matter and microbial activity that exists in this, or that doesn't exist in this parcel of land right now.
This dam will play a key role in keeping the water in the mountains and serve as an infrastructure to irrigate the agroforest while having enough volume to help local authorities in the fight against wildfires.
So this dam was built in the 80s, and it wasn't built by us, it was built by other people, and it's badly constructed, it's full of leaks, and it's not retaining water. So we're going to rebuild this, and we're going to use it to retain water from rain and from the rivers. And we're going to use that water for irrigation of the forests and some fields like the terraces that are below of it. And we're going to also incorporate a lot of aquatic plants and increase the biodiversity of everything as a whole around this whole area.
We could not have done this job by ourselves. Setting up a water reservoir capable of more than 1 million liters needs to be done by professionals and planned by engineers to assure a long-lasting dam that will serve not only the project but protect the mountains. We will start on the east terrace, and the idea is to improve the old terraces that were in place. They are very steep slopes in the narrow terrace area, and they couldn't keep up with the soil erosion. So the main idea for this rework is to make the terraces wider and the slopes less steep. This will allow us to plant more than 30 fruit species, fast-growing biomass plants, and diverse herbaceous plants that will enhance the soil fertility and create abundance. And the less steep slopes will provide space for flowering shrubs that will slow waterfall, reduce soil erosion, and attract pollinators. To rebuild the terraces, we had the help of our machinist friend Lorenzo, starting on the east side and then moving on to the west. And as soon as the east side was finished, it was time for our own skilled workers to enter the scene.
Oh, brilliant.
The Regen Ranger team lost no time in bringing up logs to create small log barriers on the slopes that will improve the erosion resistance and be a support for the mixture of herbaceous plants that we are going to use in this area. Everything was done using wood from the monocultures of eucalyptus and mimosas that we have been cutting on our land, making it a full circle. And while we did the west side, we also took good care of our waterline. Years of erosion from the poor previous design and from the monoculture of eucalyptus that was once there. This line was full of debris and the banks were overgrown by brambles and eucalyptus. To top it off, we added a small pond to keep moisture in the air and create a habitat for local flora and fauna, and as always, prevent erosion. You can learn more about that in episode 10. And on a beautiful misty morning, the sun shines quietly through the clouds, announcing the best part of this project, the beginning of planting after months of planning and hard work.
Happy for finally be planting the terraces?
Yes. We're starting with the slopes because it's important to avoid erosion that might happen here with the winter rains. So we're going to start with that. And once that's ready, we can safely and comfortably plant the agroforest lines.
Esta parte algumas vezes é complicada porque tem pedras, cima atrás assim pedras grandes mesmo assim.
Mas é da equipa, por isso ele já está habituado a levar com pedras.
Such a big endeavor can only be possible by making the community come together. Many volunteers joined us on different occasions to help plant slopes, and we are incredibly grateful for this dedication. And you too can become part of this regeneration. Become a patron now and help us bring life back to these mountains. Every tier gets the same perks because we believe that every contribution matters. And the best perk to give is to keep reforesting for you. To make the terraces work, there were lots of soil amendments needed. Thanks to years of erosion and soil depletion by the invasive cultures of eucalyptus, we were left with dry and rocky dirt. Besides tilling the earth to make it more receptive to new plants, we also had to improve the quality of the soil. Mixing it with compost and manure was essential in helping plants thrive in this depleted soil. If you want us to explain the Silvera-Tech planting method in the upcoming videos, let us know in the comments. We used wood chips to create thick mulch on the agroforest lines, which are great for moisture retention and weed control. Our agroforest is shaped by the unique rhythm of terraces and slopes. On the slopes, we've planted species that help protect the soil and prevent erosion. In the centre of each terrace, we'll create a 1 meter wide planting strip, leaving 50 centimeter paths on both sides for easy access. For the tree layer, we'll alternate, planting one fruit tree for every 3 fast-growing biomass trees. For ground cover, we will directly sow sunflowers and phacelia. And along the terrace edge, we'll plant vetiver, our living barrier for soil erosion. Once again, volunteers from all over the world came to the rescue. Even companies like Hades did team retreats with us to help plant vetiver on the edges. Thanks for helping us out, everyone. And in the blink of an eye, or so it seems, everything changed. The riverbanks were now green, the pond is now home to many tadpoles, gold striped salamanders, and even water snakes. At the same time, the terraces are becoming greener day by day. We know the time scale of nature is slow in the grand scheme of things, but when you follow its path daily, it sure does not seem slow. It is a privilege to witness nature's succession with our own eyes. Everything felt so alive. The ecosystem was getting richer. Butterflies, birds, and bees filled the air, painting a vivid picture of harmony and hope. Unfortunately, the very thing that this agroforest was promised to fight was its very own demise. Summer heat brought what we feared, and a massive wildfire swept through our land. And in a few days, months of hard work vanished in front of our eyes.
In the less than 10% of the land that wasn't ravaged by the wildfire that hit us in August, there are small pockets that survived. The most significant one would be the agroforest, which used to be a eucalyptus monoculture. And what took us pretty much over a year and a half in terms of planning, gathering material, building up the team, was destroyed in a little less than 3 days. It still served part of that purpose. It very likely saved our base camp. It helped protect this whole section of the waterline and the small pockets of biodiversity here, which were one of the few that survived around here. It's one of the few areas that still has some green in it, even though we can start seeing oaks sprouting again. This was the major pocket of surviving green.
But in the end, it wasn't all for nothing. Although the agroforest didn't reach its full potential, it showed us it was already capable of saving our base camp, protecting the waterline, and being a ray of green in this scarred land. In the end, the agroforest is a reminder of what resilience is. In the debris of the burnt irrigation system, the scarred terraces, and the deer devouring its remnants, it remained as one of the few green spots after the fire. Its slopes are now getting greener, and its terraces are set for a brighter future. Thank you for being here, and take care.